Hi, everyone. It's Lauren Souders here from NeuroVlog. Today, I'm going to bring you some clinical application from best evidence in 5 minutes or less. So today, we are going to talk about bilateral priming of the upper extremity post-stroke. So what is bilateral priming? Who does it work for? So today, I'm going to base this off of a study by Catherine Stanier as the primary author from 2014. If you don't follow Catherine Stanier, you should. She has wonderful work in this space. She's out of the University of Auckland, PhD in movement neuroscience. Okay, so what she did, she had a RCT where she had two groups, randomized group, whether you were a primed group, which was your intervention, or your control group. And these patients had to be in the subacute stage, only one ischemic stroke. They had to have fairly good movement. We know that the baseline average between both groups on the action research arm test, or ARAT, was a 26 to 27. So fairly good movement at baseline. And they had to have little to no spasticity. They had to have no neglect, great attention. And they also had to have no contraindications for MRI or transcranial magnetic stimulation, or TMS. Because what they did is they also found in both groups, roughly 75% of those individuals had a MEP, or motor evoked potential positive, when they were looking at the integrity of the corticospinal tract. So that tells us that these patients also had a good communication from brain to the limb. So what they did, so in bilateral priming, these patients were seeing a physiotherapist, had physiotherapy 5 days a week, and 15 minutes prior to each of the weekday physiotherapy sessions, they had a coupling mechanical device for bilateral bimanual movements of wrist extension. They had to achieve anywhere from what they could, 500 to 1500 repetitions prior to even going to their therapy. Now, the other thing is that on the impaired side, you didn't have to have much active wrist extension, but if it caught a flicker, it would do that for you. So there is some intention there with your patient of engaging where they're actually focusing and thinking, I need to try to move this. And so there's a lot going on that we're taxing the brain with when doing these repetitions and then trying to do a mass repetition of this prior to what we do. Now, the control group, they had bilateral standard tens on the volar aspects of their forearm doing wrist extension, had a 2 second ramp up, 15 second extension with 2 second ramp down. And basically, they could only do one repetition per minute for 15 minutes. So think about that. They only had 15 repetitions. Also, yes, they have ramp up and ramp down, and some of them might have been engaging and trying to do the movement themselves. But let's be honest, it's doing the movement for them as well. So they might not, I could be wrong, but they might not be well engaged into the activity as well. Now, what did they find? So they were trying to see how quickly could somebody hit their plateau within the 12 weeks to 26 weeks. And their plateau definition is that if you reach 75% or more of what you could achieve on the primary outcome measure, which is the ARAT, and that's roughly around 43 points. So what they had found is that in the prime group, they were 3 times more likely to reach that plateau than the people who didn't. So the recovery was much quicker. And what they also found is there was great improvement in rebalancing and excitability and inhibition when it came to the neurophysiological measures. So this is all wonderful news. Now, how do we actually clinically apply it? What this is telling us, what I see from my aspect, is that if you have a high-level patient that seems to have a fair amount of decent movement, what you're going to want to do, besides the best evidence that you know in your treatments, is that train them before to do a task that is bilateral upper extremity integrated. It has mass repetition value to it, and it is something that they are engaged in, something they want to do. Can it be a task? Sure. Why not? It's better than none. And plus, we know task-based practice does yield some really great outcomes as well. So kind of catering that to your patient and having them try to do as many repetitions as possible bilaterally together, mirroring those movements, might help prime for a wonderful motor recovery and therapy session with you. So that is all I have for you. I will put the article down below. If you have any questions, please reach out. And also, if you're already doing bilateral priming as a therapist, you are awesome. Please, so actually, Put it down in the comments what you're actually doing with your patients and share with your fellow colleagues. As always, trying to get this to you in 5 minutes or less. And I think I achieved that. I think I did. Okay. So everyone, as always, have a good one. See you later.